Hello friends, I am Vikram from EasyOn Technologies. Welcome to my Spring Data video series. In this video, I will talk about basic customization of entity class as I am doing in my project. Also, we will generate the repository interface for all the entity classes, right? So let's begin. So these are the classes we have generated through the reverse engineering in previous video. Let's talk about what are the changes we required here, because this is all generated by the tool and probably some changes you required as per your project or as per your naming standards or some best practices. So let's talk about those things. Before moving to the guideline, let's quickly revise the database schema. So these are the set of tables I am using in this small project work inquiry application, and we have done the reverse engineering. I will quickly summarize the process of doing this reverse engineering. So we have presentation for this. So look at this here. From the NetBeans you can generate all the classes. So from the persistence here, you can select the entity classes from database and you can select all the tables. Then you can customize some options here as visible in the screen. Then you can change the collection type here for association. So I'm using here list and I have unchecked all these options. We have already done all these steps in previous videos, and now let's see the customization. So when you see the generated class, when you have like this inquiry course C small here, so the it is generating like this. I required like this C capital because there are two words and I'm using camel case naming convention and I prefer this one. So this is the change we required here. So we have already done this. I'll show you that. This is inquiry source, I think. Inquiry course. Look at this inquiry course. I'm going to change this. Inquiry course, capital C. Refactor this. I have done the refactor. Okay. Similarly, I have changed the inquiry source and inquiry course. Right. Now come to the next point. Then I have I'm planning to remove the named queries, which is automatically generated. Right. So let me quickly remove all the named queries generated here in your entity class. So remove this. I have removed this. Then delete quickly from all the classes like this. Similarly from the course, from inquiry also I am going to remove this. I'm not using right now, but if there is a need you can keep the named query here. It is already deleted. Now delete the named queries from follow-up and then from the institute. I have deleted this. Correct. This is a good idea. If you required, you can add some more customized named queries as per the use case, but I'm not using here. Now this is very important. The next thing is, this is a one-to-many association I'm removing here because I don't want this, because it is actually mapped by the list, and if someone mistakenly loaded the parent and if all the childs are loaded associated with that parent, probably it will suck all the memory. So I do not use this relation, but I keep the property here. So what I'm doing here, actually I delete this one-to-many annotation, and I had two annotations here, JSON include when it is not null, and I'm using here transient. Transient means if you have removed one to many and if you keep this field here, it will treat this inquiry list as your database column. So I don't want to link up with this property with the database, so I marked this transient, so this will never be associated with the database field. Okay, but this property can be used to carry some data from you know, controller to your UI, or you can convert this in the JSON format. So for that purpose, I prefer to keep this property. Just I don't want to link up with the database. Okay, so this is the major change I am doing here. And before showing this, I will show you why I am doing this. So just take one entity here. For example, I'm going to show you through this. Let's see, this is institute, right? Institute has some list property here. List, it has a list here in list of inquiries. I will show you the problem here, just a minute. Or it is better, I should go with that example which is already covered in the previous videos. So that is inquiry source, I think. So this is the source. I have removed this relation. Just a minute, I will enable this and comment these things. Okay, this is mapped to the inquiry source. Now I will show you this list of inquiry sources from the controller. For testing purpose, I am going to map one test source list. This is what we have added here, test source list. All the inquiry sources will be listed here from this. Just a minute, remove this. It is getting here, find all test inquiry source list. Run this and see the error. I'm loading here inquiry source, and inquiry source has a list of inquiry property, and look at the problem. Slash, okay, look at this problem. I have loaded the data here, so many things it has added in the recursive fashion, and it is you know, out of some Stack Overflow somewhere. It is stuck around some Stack Overflow due to the infinite recursion, right? I will show you the problem. Actually, I have only 5 to 6 sources. Only these should be displayed on the page when it is converted in the JSON. But the problem is, when it is fetching one source, it is fetching its all the inquiries, right? Then inquiry has something else, so it is fetching those properties also. So when from the inquiry, it is again going to all the sources. Just a minute. Yes, it has a relation for inquiry source. So it is fetching inquiry source, then it's all inquiries, then associated inquiry source again. So this is actually a kind of recursive relation it is forming. It is generating the error in the console. I will show you that error. This will help you to understand and solve the error. It has generated the error here. This is Stack Overflow error, infinite recursion. So getting the problem why it is generating this infinite recursion, and this is done while converting your data into the JSON format, because Jackson parser is used behind the scene to convert this Java object into the JSON format. But when it is internally used in the server side things, you are not converting into the JSON, probably it will not create this error, because it is done in the, it is internally working through the lazy loading mode. When you are loading the parent, it's all the childs will not be loaded automatically, they all are lazy. But when you are doing the serialization, it is going to fetch the data and convert into the JSON, and that at that time it is failed. So I don't want this relation, and that's why I suggest you to comment out this, comment this and uncomment these things. This is important, right? I hope you understand. So that when the when I'm saying here JSON include, means if you have some list of inquiries here, it will be sent to the browser, it will be converted into the JSON format if it is not null, and this is not linked with the database because I don't want to treat this inquiry list as my database column in the inquiry source table, right? So I have this transient, I have added transient and JSON include. These two things are very important. Now this you have to remove all these relations, you have to repeat all the same job in all the domain classes, right? So you have to do this for all. I have done for one, but we'll do it for all. Right now look at the same thing. Now you can see the actual data. It has stopped that recursion process, and you will see here this is Google search first, website second, newspaper third, and this is just dial fourth, and this is five, right? We have actually five data here. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and that's what it is correctly converted into the JSON format. So this is one good idea we are using in project, and we have not faced any problem till now, right? Now let me talk about few more things. So after this change, we have few things here. Child class knows about its parent, whereas parent does not know about its child, right? That's what I am doing here. I have removed the relation from parent to child, which is one to many. But when you go to inquiry, this inquiry has this property. Look at this inquiry source. I keep this relation many to one. This is actually a foreign key kind of relation here. So inquiry has a reference of the inquiry source. I required this and I'm using this, right? So this is the important relation. It is used to bind the parent, because when you are talking about inquiry, it has knowledge about the source. This inquiry is from this particular source. So keep this relation here. Now the next point is you required here constructors, right? So constructor is all based on your choices. You can add, you know, as many as constructors based on their need and parameters, right? Now this is seventh point. And there is one more thing. When you have a table like contact table, in my case it has two references of address table. I will show you that. So look at this. If you look at my schema here, it has two references. Look at this. This is a contact table, and contact has two references. It's a local address and permanent address from the address table, right? So while reverse engineering, it has generated like this. It has generated the code like this. I will show you that. Just a minute. Say contact. And contact has the addresses. Look at the addresses. This is address one. You can see this property. This is address. This is actually the local address, and this is second one is a permanent address. So what we can do here, we can change this property name like this. This is address, it's a local address, and I'll make it permanent address. This is correct. And you have to delete the properties, delete the associated getter setter, and we can regenerate the getter and setters here. Local address and permanent addresses, correct? This is another change I am doing here. And what else we required here? This is what I have mentioned here. So local address and permanent address from address and address one, you have to you know, use the correct name so that you can understand this, right? Now the next thing is you must ensure the hasCode and equals method. It is automatically generated because it is internally recognizing your entities uniquely, identifying your unique objects. So this is some internal things in Hibernate. Probably if you are coming from the Hibernate background, you may understand the need of this hasCode and equals method. So it is automatically generated here, and I'm not doing any change here, just ensure it. So it is always there. Okay, now this is how actually the class looks like. Okay, so we have already seen that. I'm not going to show this, and this is actually the generated things. So you understand what are the things we required here to modify in the entity classes. So you have to repeat these guidelines for all the classes. And one important one more thing I am going to do here is a repository I need to generate for all the domain classes. So we have generated for inquiry source because we have done some CRUD operation in previous project for the inquiry source entity, and now you can generate for other also. So this is my tool, can help you to generate the code. You can go to the Spring framework, you can select Spring framework, and you can generate the repository interface, and you can learn about the description it has given here. Next here, and tell the name of your repository class. For example, we have entity here address, so you can make it address repository. The entity class is your address class, and ID is actually your long. I'm using all the long IDs for primary key. Done. It will create the interface for me, and this is creating from the curl repository. And what we can do, we should do actually from the JPA repository. I recommend to use from the JPA repository. So this is based on your requirement. JPA repository is a child interface of the CRUD repository or CRUD repository, whatever you call it. Remove this, and you need to import this address. Similarly, you can this is done, correct? Similarly, you can generate for other entity class repository interface from this. This is contact repository. So contact repository, you can generate from the JPA repository. There is a provision here to choose the base interface, so JPA repository is a better choice. And this is your contact, and this is again long, correct? All right, it is generating here correctly. Import this. So I have done the import for this, and I'm sure you can create the other interface for other entities also. So this is the way we can customize few things, and I think this is enough for this video. I hope you enjoyed this. Thanks for watching, and see you in next video. Also, don't forget to subscribe my channel for more updates.